Hello, today we shall see the various parts of the ring frame. We are going to see the creel, we are going to see the spindle, details of the lappet, balloon control ring, as well as the separators. So this is the bobbin creel on ring frame. The roving frame, whatever the bobbins are delivered, they come to the ring frame, either automatically or manually they are brought here. And the bobbin creel, one must remember that it must be simple in design and must allow for tension-free unwinding to prevent false drafts as well as end breaks. So one must take care that during unwinding, minimum amount of tension is applied so that one does not come across false drafts and therefore change in the count, as well as end breakages are minimum. So this is a picture of the ring frame where one can see the roving bobbins over here, and this is a close-up of that image here which shows the suspension which is for the roving bobbin, which we shall see in the next slide in detail. So this is another view of this particular creel. So with this we look at the bobbin suspension pivots. And the bobbin suspension pivots are bolted on the support rails, which are actually triangular tubings, and which is shown as two over here, arranged one behind the other. And it is such suspension pivots are one per spindle. So we can see here the retainer 6 that is there over here, which is shown. It is the holding device for the bobbin. This retainer can swing outwards and retract alternately, so it can come out and go inside whenever the ring 5, that is this ring 5, if it is taken up and pushed here, then in that case this retainer will come out and be pushed inside. So this is how it works when this particular ring number 5, which is marked here, is taken upwards. The swinging out of the retainer holds the full roving bobbin and the retraction releases the empty bobbin. So this is a very easy way of creeling. When we push the roving bobbin upwards, it will automatically go and fix itself in this particular retainer here. And again, when we want to remove the empty bobbin from this suspension, then we again need to push this ring and take the bobbin out. The pivots are mounted in ball bearings. So at the top they are mounted in ball bearings so that any rotation whatsoever is happening over here, it exerts a minimum tension on the roving beam that is being unwound. Also it has a braking device that would gently stop the bobbin from rotating too fast. So let us take a look at the video over here by Reeter, which is an automatic roving bobbin transport system. This is automatic docking at the roving frame. They are being transported to the ring frame. one can see the bobbin cleaner here, where whatever little bit roving has been left on the bobbin, it is being removed. And again, the empty bobbins are ready. They can be transported back to the roving crane. So with this, let us take a look at the next slide. The spindle construction. We will look in detail into the spindle construction. So this is a spindle. We will one by one look at the various parts that are there. One here is the thread guide eyelet that is shown over here. After drafting system and the ring and traveler combination, these are the two most important parts. After this, the third important element is the spindle, and it is one of the most third most important, one can say, important machine component. Spindle speeds are limited to 25,000 rpm and may actually be lower due to the limitation imposed by the traveler speed, yarn tension, as well as the spinning triangle zone. Because of these three reasons, the spindle speeds might be limited to either 25, which is actually the claim, but it will be somewhere lower than this. So in the diagram, one can see the lappet is marked as 1. The BCR or the balloon control ring is marked as 2 over here, which we shall see in details later on. And the ring is marked as 3. The other parts are, the spindle consists of two distinct parts. The spindle center shaft, which is marked as 4, that is this portion of the spindle, which is made of aluminium alloy, and the enclosed bearing housing 7 that is marked over here. The bottom end of the shaft is the valve. So when this is a shaft, the bottom end of it, this is the valve. The bearing section is bolted to the ring rail 6. So this is the ring rail marked 6 over here, and the bearing section is bolted to the ring rail by the nut 8, which is shown over here. The spindle provides a firm grip to the bobbin. This spindle will provide a firm grip. The bobbin is going to sit on this, and it is going to provide a firm grip so that when the spindle rotates, the bobbin will rotate along with it at the same speed. So let us take a look at the valve here in little bit in detail. This is the bobbin. This is the ring rail. This is the spindle tape where the tape is going around, and the tape is driven by, say, the motor, and from there the speed is transferred to the spindle valve, because of which the spindle will start rotating. And because bobbin is fixed, is going to be sitting on the spindle, and they will rotate as one single piece. So this is the valve. The cap valve is hollow and can therefore be fitted on the spindle collar. The driving belt runs on the valve to drive the spindle. So we have seen this is the valve that is there, marked as 5 over here. And if we were to look at it in a little bit of detail, this is the valve, this portion. And we can see this piece, this is a hollow piece which is sitting on the spindle collar. The driving belt will run on this valve and drive the spindle as it is running on it. The size and shape of the valve are important. If the size is kept small, then high speeds can be achieved at lower drive speeds, resulting in low energy consumption. So if this, we can make it small, then obviously this will be run, we can run at a higher speed by just using a lower drive speed at the same time, and therefore it will automatically result in lower energy consumption. But there is a disadvantage here, that from the slippage point of view, for slippage free running, the diameter must not be too small. The diameter of the valve therefore would be around 19 mm to 22 mm, which is a normal case which is used. The bearing housing. The spindle bearing consists of two parts. We have seen the spindle itself was divided into two parts. The one was the shaft and the other was the bearing. Now we come to the bearing, and this is the image of the bearing, which is the lower portion of the spindle. And again, this will consist of two part, that is the spindle collar, which is a neck bearing, which is shown over here, and a spindle step foot bearing, which is shown over here. So we have this foot bearing over here, which will support the spindle for during driving, and this is the neck bearing. The spindle collar bearing is mostly a roller bearing type. The spindle step bearing, due to its limited lateral swing, helps in centering the spindle during its running. So there is some lateral movement to this, rather it happens during running, that there is some lateral swing that happens at the bottom at the step bearing, and because of this particular lateral swing, centering of the spindle automatically takes place. So we'll see how it happens. There is also a spring here at the bottom which has been shown from the top. This blue colored circle, we can imagine that to be the bottom portion of the spindle. So oil is circulated through the slots, and the damping spiral damps the vibration in the spindle step and therefore stabilizes the spindle shaft during high speed running. So the oil and also this particular spring that is there, which is being used here at the bottom, will both help in stabilizing the spindle and damps the vibration, if at all any vibrations are generated over here in the spindle step itself. So the resistance that the oil has to overcome, so it is all oiled, and the resistance the oil has to overcome when it flows from one side to the another. So if in case there is a lateral movement of the step over here, a step bearing at the bottom, then the spindle will be moving laterally, maybe towards the left. This is what is being shown here. And when that happens, the oil tries to flow from one side to the other due to the spindle being deflected. So spindle gets deflected, so the oil is forced to come on the other side, because the spindle will compress the spring on this side. So whatever oil is there over here, it will try to enter this area. So as it is moving, because of the resistance that the oil is applying while moving, or rather flowing from one side to the other, because of that, it damps the vibration, if at all anything is generated in the spindle step itself, and consequently the shaft also, that is the upper part of the spindle also, the vibrations are dampened. So with this, let us come to the influence of the spindle. So this is an image of an actual spindle, and we can see the shaft is there. There are some sort of gripping devices which help in gripping the bobbin, both at the top as well as the bottom. So the spindles and the spindle drive have an influence on the energy consumption. First influence would be on the energy consumption. Second would be the noise levels. Then the spindle running behavior also influences certain factors like balancing errors and the eccentricity relative to the ring, which will further go on to affect the quality of the yarn as well as the ends down frequency. So basically the spindle will influence four major factors, that is energy consumption, noise level, quality of the yarn, as well as ends down frequency. So centering of the spindles relative to the rings is important because it impacts almost all the yarn parameters, and therefore time to time centering is needed. They change positions because they operate independent of each other. There is no connection between the spindle and the ring. They are running independently, and that is why from time to time they may the settings may change, and because of this one needs to keep on centering them every time or more frequently, and needs need to be checked. So centering was done earlier by moving the spindle. So spindle would be moved initially in the olden days. The spindle was moved and centering was done. The centering was done for getting the spindle exactly at the center of the ring and align it with the thread guide, which we shall see. So it was done by moving the spindle, but nowadays the ring is adjusted relative to the spindle. Also, mechanical or electronic devices are sometimes used for centering. So with this, let us look at the spindle drive. There are basically three types of spindle drive. Tape drive, which drives four spindles at a time. Then there are tangential belt drives and direct drives. We shall see each one by one. Short staple spinning uses only two group drives in the form of four spindle tape drive and the tangential belt drive. So only two types are being used in the short staple spinning. So only these two will be discussed in detail. The four spindle drive is advantageous in terms of lower power consumption, noise, and are easier to replace also. So this is how it looks. Four spindles, one, two on either side of the machine, are driven in this manner by using a single tape. The tape drives two spindles on one side and another two spindles on the other side of the machine, as can be seen here. The tape passes over a drive pulley. This is a drive pulley. It passes over the drive pulley, and there are also one to two tension rollers. There are tension rollers which are seen over here, and these tension rollers ensure good uniform tension on the tape. So with this, we will look at the types of tangential belt drives. The belt extends from a motor to the inner side of each spindle. So one can see here, one single motor will be there, which will drive the belt, and it will extend all along the machine, complete entire machine. So pressure rolls are there somewhere in between, which will ensure uniform pressure of the belts against all the spindles. So pressure rollers like this are applied on the inner side, where these particular pressure rolls apply pressure and keep the belts in contact with the spindles. So what we are seeing here is a double belt drive, two separate belt drives. That is, there are two belts one can see over here. This is one belt. Although the motor is one, there are two belts, one driving one side of the machine and the other one on the other side. So this system gives a better uniformity of spindle speeds. In single belt, one endless belt drives the spindles on both machine sides. So there may be considerable variation in tension in the belts in the system, especially if the machine is too long. So this is the single belt drive, where one single belt is running throughout and running and driving both the sides or the spindles on both the sides of the machine. So with this, we come to the advantages of both these types of tangential belt drives over the four spindle drive. The tangential belt drive is widely used and has the following advantages. Elimination of drive components under the machine. So drive components are not there below the machine. And because of this, there will be less air disturbance under this machine, and possibly a slightly lower maintenance also may be an advantage over here when we come to tangential belt drives. Then there is one more type of drive, which is again tangential, but it is a grouped drive. So group drives are increasingly being used instead of single belt or double belt tangential belt drives. In group drives, groups of spindles are driven by a single belt. So one would take certain amount, say maybe 50 spindles, and drive them together as one, and there will be two or three motors or five motors depending on the number of spindles that are there on the machine. But then one care has to be taken that the speeds of each of these motors must be synchronized. So there must be a guarantee of speed synchronization, otherwise there will be a variation in speeds from spindle to spindle, or rather group to group. So with this, we come to the next topic, where we are going to study about all these parts. That is the yarn guide, which is the lappet, which can be seen over here. This is the lappet, the position. It is just above the spindle. Then there is the balloon control ring. One can see this ring over here, which is called as a balloon control ring. And then we also see a balloon separator. That is this partitions that one sees. These are the balloon separators. Then one more ring and traveler is shown, which we are aware of. Later on, we shall study. In the future lectures, we shall study this ring and traveler in detail. In today's lecture, we shall look into detail of the lappet, or rather the yarn guide, the balloon control ring, and the balloon separator. So with this, we come to the lappet or the thread guide. The thread guide is fitted just above the spindle. The material being delivered by the drafting system, whatever front roller delivers, it is being guided centrally along the spindle axis. So it has to be guided centrally. If this is spindle, this is the lappet or the thread guide. It is nothing but something like a pigtail. And from sideways, side view, it would look like this. This is the lappet. And the thread guide consists of a bent wire eyelet, which is shown as O over here. This is the eyelet. And a pivotable arm K. This is a pivotable arm K. This can move, or you can just swing this in this manner. That is fitted on a lappet rail, which is called as R over here. This particular lappet rail extends over the entire length of the machine. That means all the thread guides that are there for each spindle. They are all mounted on the lappet rail, and which extends over the entire length of the machine. The guide is adjustable both sideways and forward backward to allow for centering of the thread guide along the axis of the spindle. So one must remember that this thread guide must be exactly at the center. This setting also we shall see a little bit in detail. The eyelet wouldn't be exactly the center, we shall see that. But before we see that, we should know how it can be adjusted. So this particular lappet can move sideways, it can be adjusted, the setting can be done sideways like this, horizontally, and even forward backward. That means it can move forward backward. So with these two movements, one can easily keep this eyelet wherever we want along the axis of the spindle. So the guide rail can be raised and lowered with the thread guides and perform the same movement as the ring rail. So this guide rail that is there, on which all the thread guides are mounted, this rail can be moved up and down or raised and lowered exactly just like the ring rail, the way it is moving while building the cop. And that means it is going to be raised and lowered during layering traverse, and also be lifted by small amounts during switching traverse. So both these motions are there to this particular guide rail, which will carry the thread guides. But the traverse that is given wouldn't be as large as that given to the ring rail. It has got a slightly smaller traverse. So with this, we come to the traverse to the thread guide rail. Why exactly this thread guide rail needs to be having a traverse? The thread guide rail is raised and lowered corresponding to the ring rail movement. In the figure, it is shown that the balloon height is maintained at all the three winding positions of the bobbin. There are three winding positions that are shown from bottom to the slightly in the middle and the top. If we were to give this movement, rising movement, to the lappet rail or the thread guide rail also, then in that case the balloon, we can see the size and the height of it is almost the same throughout, from the start of the bobbin to the end of the bobbin. So this is the exact reason why this also, the thread guide rail is raised. If it is not raised, if it is say at this position itself from start to the end, then every time when the bobbin is being built somewhere in the middle or at the top, the balloon height would have reduced, and this would cause tension variations from bottom to the top in the thread. And there, because of the tension variation that is there, even it would affect the yarn quality. So what is done is consistent height is maintained for the balloon, and the thread guide rail or the lappet rail is taken, has given a movement exactly like the ring rail. If there were no vertical movement to the thread guide rail, the changes in the balloon height would lead to huge differences in the yarn tension, resulting in increased end breakages and deterioration in the yarn properties. So with this, let us look at the centering of the thread guide. The thread guides, we have already mentioned that they need to be centered from time to time. And for this centering, we are going to use a pointer, which is S, which is shown over here. This S can be fitted on the spindle only for the sake of setting this particular lappet. Now, since the yarn path does not run through the center of the yarn guide O, what we mean by this is the yarn would not exactly be running vertically at the center of O, but it will be coming from the front roller somewhere over here, and it will be taking a turn or other brush against this inner side of the eyelet over here. So the yarn path is exactly not at the center of the yarn guide O, but somewhere at the side. So therefore, the point of the setting device must be directed towards the inner side of the guide. So if you see, draw a line over here, one can see that this is directed towards more towards the inner side of the eyelet, even if the center of this eyelet is somewhere towards the left. Therefore, the tip of the pointer gauge is set in line with the inside edge of the eyelet. So with this, now we come to the balloon control ring, which was the one more element that was there. So the longer spindles and cops which are there on the modern ring frames, they result in balloon formation of correspondingly larger heights. So a balloon, a high balloon poses the following problems. A large balloon diameter causes space problems between spindles because it will have a larger diameter. A large balloon also leads to a high air drag, leading to balloon instability and increased danger of balloon collapse also. The problems due to large balloon can be tackled by either increasing the yarn tension, that is by using a heavier traveler, which we shall see later on. But using a heavier traveler means it would also lead to more end breakages. So this option will not be opted normally. Or the second option could be using the balloon control rings, which is also known as BCRs. So what does a balloon control ring exactly do? It divides a balloon into two smaller sub-balloons. So if this is a balloon control ring, this is a normal ring on which the traveler is running. There is one ring which is there in between the thread guide and the ring. And this control ring will divide the balloon. If it was just one single balloon, it would have been if this balloon control ring was not there. But since this is there now, it will divide it into two parts. And because of this, the stability is improved. In spite of the large overall height, the overall height is the same, it is large. But the double balloon is thoroughly stable even at low yarn tensions. So without using a heavier traveler over here, we can go for a much more stable balloon just by dividing it into two or multiple balloons. So BCRs have lifting movement similar to that of the ring rail, but with a smaller stroke. So it is going to be similar to the lappet rail that we just saw. BCR also allows for higher speeds, but can result in excessive rubbing of the yarn, leading to yarn hairiness and fly generation. In case of thermoplastic yarns, one must be very careful because whatever yarn, as it is rotating, it will be rubbed against this balloon control ring. And because it would be thermoplastic, mostly man-made fibers are thermoplastic, they would lead to, because of the rubbing, there would be a generation of heat which would lead to creation of melt spots, which is a defect in the yarn. So one must be careful while using a balloon control ring. So with this, we come to the next topic of discussion, that is the balloon separators. Whenever an end breaks, the broken end lashes around a spindle. And in the absence of protective devices, this broken end causes ends down on the neighboring spindles, leading to continuous ends down along the row of spindles. That means if suppose one yarn breaks at one particular spindle, then the yarn would lash out on the neighboring spindles and try to break even the neighboring yarns. And in that way, it's a cascading effect. All the spindle yarns would break down. So to prevent that, what we do is we have a balloon separator between each spindle. So the green partition that one can see, these are the balloon separators. So separator plates of aluminium or plastic are arranged between the individual spindles to prevent multiple end breakages. So this is a simple part actually, but a very important one, which will prevent multiple end breakages on adjacent spindles. So with this, we have seen all the parts, different various parts. We have seen the creel, we have seen the lappets, we have seen even the spindle in detail. We have seen the balloon control ring as well as a balloon separator. So with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.